asked you to note was that if you thought of gamma A B mu in that in the way that you might think of A mu. So these two indices are thought of as matrix indices, and this as a space-time index. Okay? And then you form the same combination that you would here. What would that be? That would be del mu gamma A B mu minus del mu gamma A B mu plus gamma A theta mu gamma theta B mu minus gamma theta theta mu gamma theta B. Okay? And this was make sure I get the sign of the last two terms right. That is just the first index of the matrix upper level. That is always the tough one. Yeah, that's right. Okay, so this is the expression for R AB union. Okay? So, just structurally, there's a close analogy between potentials, AMUs, and gammas, and field strengths and curvatures. Okay? This is something that is good to keep in mind, at least to help you to remember the formula and to help you remember various other things. Okay, the Bianchi identity that we proved also can be remembered in this language. The Bianchi identity for gauge theory was del alpha f beta gamma cyclically symmetrized is equal to zero. Okay, what would this way of thinking of that suggest? This would suggest that your Bianchi identity was gamma n d mu mu comma commutator phi psych mu mu phi is equal to zero, and that's precisely the identity we proved in this case. Now, well, this was not a co-identity, admitting the fact that this is not an ordinary but a co-identity. Okay?
So the first identity, what is used? I mean, the fact that is behind this is that d square is zero. I mean, the exterior differential operator is zero.
That
the first one, the gauge case.
That d square is zero. Yes.
In the second one, or is it the same thing, or is it?
We proved it last class. No. Okay. Okay. In some sense, yes. In some sense, yeah. Right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So just keep this analogy in mind. It will deepen as we go along when we talk about the tetrad formalism of general relativity. But it's useful at least to remember formulas. Okay. Now, the next thing we talked about was now that we have curvature completely in our hands, we were able to write down the Einstein action. Okay? So we wrote down the action as minus 1 by 16 pi integral r plus integral square root lambda. Okay? But this part was the coupling to matter. This guy is matter. Okay? And we spent some time motivating why this is Einstein's action. Just to repeat the motivation and the problem behind the motivation. The motivation was that suppose you've got some unknown, you know, we don't understand gravity well yet. We don't understand the underlying theory of gravity. Suppose you've got some unknown gravitational theory at Planck scale. Well, the first thing we noted is that this scale here had dimension length squared. And we gave this length a name. It's called LP squared. Planck length squared. In the real world, the Planck length is about 10 to the minus 33 centimeters. space model. The next thing we noted was that if you had some unknown theory, some theory of gravity at a particular scale, okay, we made the following assumption. We made the assumption that there was only one length scale involved in the theory. So suppose you had some complicated quantum theory of gravity at that length scale, and energy is much lower than that, you would get some effective classical description. And we wrote down possible corrections for this action. One of the corrections we wrote down was R-squared, that was R-4. Just by dimensional analysis, this term had 1 over length squared because R had 2 derivatives. But d4x had 4 derivatives, 4x is 1 over length squared. The same reason it gave you that this term was dimensionless, and this term was np to the 4, and so on. Okay? And then a crude estimate of how these terms contributed to dynamics on length scale L gave you that this contributed like L by LP squared. This contributed like 1, and this contributed like LP squared by L squared. So a length scale is much larger than an LP. Clearly, this dominates dynamics. Okay? So, at least to the extent that we understand gravity today, we expect that there's nothing particularly sacrosanct about the Einstein term. All terms exist in gravitational action. Okay? It's just that we're probing it at a length scale is much larger than the length scale. And so all physics is dominated by this term. Okay? This sounds very nice and very satisfying, except for one problem. The problem is that if you take this logic to its conclusion, there is one more term in the action that you can write down that is even more important than Einstein's term. This was the term LP to the 4 times d4x square root g, the so-called cosmological constant. And if this term occurred, it would be more important than this term, than the Einstein term, by a factor of L squared over LP squared. Okay? And I think it is one of the central puzzles of theoretical physics today. Still, just experimentally, it's there's lots of evidence that this is the right theory of gravity, and that this term is either absent or is present with a coefficient that is not 1 over LP squared, but 1 over L Hubble squared, size of the universe. Now there's a big scale difference between 10 to the minus 33 and the size of the universe. Okay? I think that it's one of the key outstanding problems of fundamental physics. To explain why this is the case. Any naive estimate for such a term would have been the same order as this term, and that would have resulted in our universe being curved on length scales of order 10 to the power minus 33 centimeters. Not being big and huge like it is. Okay? So there's a key qualitative thing about our universe we don't understand. Why this term is absent or is so small. Okay? Modulo that, if we hide our ignorance of this bit of why this is the case, then this seems like the reason for the next term. For a long time, what people have thought was that there was some unknown, as yet unknown theoretical mechanism that sets this term to zero. You know, in the theory of supersymmetry, for instance. So in a supersymmetric theory, such a term is formed. Now, the world around us is not supersymmetric, so this is not a sufficient explanation. But that's just an example of a theoretical mechanism. So a certain symmetry could set such a term to zero. So for a long time it was assumed that for some unknown reason this term was just zero. Okay? But now that there's increasing experimental evidence that it's not zero, but it's some ridiculously small number. Set by the size of the universe. And that sounds really strange. I mean, there's no understanding for why any reasonable theory of gravity would set it to zero. There's even less understanding for why a reasonable theory of gravity would turn it to something non-zero but very much. Again, it's a key outstanding issue in my opinion. In our understanding of the basic structure of the universe. You know, it's a very basic issue. Why are we living in a universe that is big rather than curled up on time scale size? As you tend to expect. Okay? And understanding this is a key question. Okay, good. So we talked about that, but you know, modulo this issue, which one of you will hopefully help resolve. Okay? What you know this issue, it seems like a reasonable postulate to make, but this is the action. But I don't think, as you did, it turns out to be correct. Okay. Then we turn to the coupling of this action to matter. Okay? So we started talking about Einstein's equations. So we've got a Lagrangian, and we want to find the equation of motion that comes from that. So we decided to look at the Lagrangian, take the action, and look at the variations. So look at the term that was delta g mu nu times square root g times e, whatever it is, some equation of motion, which I call e. Now the e nu gets contributions from two terms, from the matter part and from the Einstein part. We computed last time the variation from the matter part. We computed it for the special example of electromagnetism. And then we discussed in general what its properties were. Okay? So we discussed in general that if you take the matter part of the structure, square root g lambda x, and you take the delta of this, we get delta of g mu nu times square root g times, and then by definition, whatever came, we call the stress tensor with a factor of 2, and perhaps a sign. Check that. Half, and we'll see. So whatever we get by varying the matter part of the action, we define to be this object T mu nu. Okay? And then in the last class we went through this little exercise to show that by this definition T mu nu was always conserved. Okay? And let me remind you of the simple demonstration of that fact. The demonstration went as follows. It went as follows. It says that, look, suppose you take any generally covariant action and vary all fields by a coordinate transformation. Then the variation of the action is zero. That's clear. Now, the fields that you have to vary are the matter fields and the metric. Put this to be zero. If you vary either matter, but keep metric fixed, try the metric, keep matter fixed, you won't get zero. But the whole thing is zero. Now let's. This is true for variation for coordinate. But now, and so far, what I said was kind of matter. It's true for arbitrary variations, and it's true off shell without imposing equations on it. However, on shell there is something else that we know. There is any variation of the matter fields on shell to first order gives you vanishing action. Is that? That's the principle that you use to derive the equations of motion. So, if you put these two things together, all the solutions to the equations of motion, a coordinate variation of the metric does not change the action. Of the metric, leaving matter fixed, does not change the action. This is not a kind of matter statement. It's true only when the matter fields obey the action. But we have an information, please note that exercise which I suggested, which was to show that, but that if you take x mu goes to x mu plus zeta mu, it's an arbitrary vector field to first order, the change in the metric was equal to up to a plus minus sign that I could remember, del mu zeta mu plus del mu zeta mu. Okay? This is sometimes, by the way, just as an aside, coordinate transformations that leave the form of the metric unchanged are called isometries. And infinitesimal coordinate transformations that leave the form of the metric unchanged are parametrized by infinitesimal transformations are parametrized by vector field, which is zeta. And zetas that parametrize infinitesimal coordinate transformations that leave the metric unchanged are called Killing vectors. Okay? This equals zero is called the Killing equation. This is the equation that determines when zeta is Killing. But that's not of concern to us. Huh? We have this delta g mu nu is given by this. Then, looking into this definition and using the fact that g mu nu is symmetric because it multiplies the symmetric variation. We concluded that that it must be that delta S, which was equal to integral del mu zeta mu square root g mu mu, was equal to zero for arbitrary zeta coordinate transformation zeta. Now we decided to do this for a coordinate transformation that vanished to the boundary of space. So we can take this equation integrated by parts. Okay? And so conclude that square root g zeta mu del square root g of zeta mu del mu d mu mu is equal to zero. Again, somebody, why was that integration by parts justified? Somebody remind me of this? What? Because? Exactly.
Gauss's theorem.
Gauss's theorem. But you see, Gauss's theorem applies to ordinary
derivatives.
Because of the formula that del mu of E mu is equal to 1 by square root g del mu square root g E mu. And so the total, the term that this and this differ by a term of this form, then this square root g cancels that and that becomes a 1.
Then we can also say that if the integration measure is taken as square root g d for x, then even the covariant derivative gives
even the covariant derivative, as long as it's acting on as long as it's acting on something with no other indices. If there were other indices in the game, then and they were not all indices, then a formula like this would not work. Okay, there were free indices. So this is specific to either having no free indices or having only anti-symmetric free indices. Okay, good. Yeah, but with that caveat, what you say is true. Okay, and then we concluded that therefore, by setting the coefficient of zeta mu to zero, the stress tensor is conserved. Okay. And of course, this stress tensor is going to form part of Einstein's equations. Okay, now we need to derive the remaining part of Einstein's equations. What do you get by taking Einstein's energy, the square root gr part, and varying the spectrum energy? Any other questions? Any questions or comments?
So when you write this total action, which whatever it is, then you said, you vary with respect to matter fields of the equations, and that implies that when you vary with respect to matter, that relevant part would be zero.
I don't understand. Say that again.
So, you said something about you vary with respect to the matter fields. Get the equation for the matter fields. And then when you, in this remaining, when you substitute the equation of forces for the matter fields, then when you vary the action, that is when you get Einstein's.
When you vary, okay. So, let me just say that first, that part of it. You see, the first manipulation we did, so the full action was Einstein's term plus the matter. S is equal to minus 1 by 16 pi or 16 pi k square root g r plus integral square root g. The first manipulation that we discussed had to do just with this. We take that term, vary it, it by itself is generally equal. We vary it with respect to the nature and matter fields. That obviously vanishes. But the variation, this is the only part that contains matter fields. So the variation with respect to matter fields also gives us something vanishing at first order by equations of motion. First statement kinematical, second statement dynamical. Therefore, on the solution to the equation of motion, the variation of this term by itself with respect to the metric field must vanish, provided that the variation of the metric is the variation caused by coordinate transformation. Okay? This is an example of a kind of an almost suspiciously slick kind of reason. that is often used in quantum field theory to great effect. It's good to get used to. It's a very beautiful argument.
Okay. Therefore, this vanishes. Okay. Now, you take the matter part. That's the first part. Now, the second part is a definition. The definition is take the matter part of the Lagrangian, vary it with respect to the metric. The coefficient of that variation, apart from a factor of square root g, is by definition the stress density. Okay? Put these two terms together, now put these two facts together, that tells you that this must be zero. For an arbitrary zeta mu. Then an integration by parts tells you that this t mu nu, that the covariant derivative of the stress tensor is special. Okay? Or a whole manipulation is just made with the matter part of the edge. Okay? Now what we're going to do when we try to find Einstein's equations, we're going to vary the metric in the whole part of the edge, in everything. And the variation of the metric will not be restricted to that variation that comes from the quad metric. We're going to look at arbitrary variation with respect to the metric. The whole action to derive Einstein's equations. Okay? So what is the action going to be? What are the equations going to be? Okay. So, delta S is equal to, well, one part we've seen, is equal to half delta G mu nu square root G T mu. That was our definition. Okay. What remains? What remains from here? Oh, as we learnt last class how to take every time I have a square root g, it should be square root minus g. Sorry. Okay, last class we learned how to take the variation of the determinant of the metric. Okay, we had this nice formula which was delta of square root minus g is equal to minus g mu nu minus delta g mu nu. Minus delta g mu nu, g mu nu by times square root. Okay? So, and thank you. Okay? So, this is just an aside. Delta S, the formula for delta S continues there. So we get minus half delta G mu nu, G mu nu times R, square root minus G. That came from varying the square root minus G. And then we remember that R itself R is equal to G mu nu, R mu nu. Okay? So another term is plus delta G mu nu, R mu nu, square root minus G. And then finally we have plus delta R mu nu. This we have to express in terms of delta of the metric. But let me just connect the terms of the equations, putting these terms together. Ignoring this for a moment, I'm going to ignore it because, as I will now prove to you, that term vanishes. That variation vanishes up to total derivatives. That variation is a total derivative. Okay? So let's just see what we get from the equation, ignoring that term for a moment. What we get is R mu nu, the coefficient of delta G mu, so R mu nu minus half G mu nu R plus half T mu nu. This part came with a 1 by 16 pi a is equal to 0.
except that we had a minus sign in this part of the action. So this whole thing is one minus. Okay, and therefore we get the equation R mu nu minus G mu nu by 2 R is equal to 8 by K T. This is Einstein's equation. Equation that determines how the metric field is determined here in the distribution of the stress tensor. But before we claim to derive Einstein's equations, I have to show you that this term is a total derivative. So that's what we're going to turn to now, unless there are questions about this. Okay. So to complete our derivation of Einstein's equations, I want to show you that square root of minus g mu nu times delta of r mu nu now to do this I'm going to use we can do this on this is a total derivative. And therefore, does not contribute to the equation. Okay. To do this, what I'm going to do is to use the kind of arguments that we started using last class. Slicker arguments than just doing the algebra completely mindlessly, just to ease things. Okay. And the style of that argumentation is always as follows. If you're trying to compute a tensor, go to a coordinate system which makes your life easy. Use the fact that it's a tensor to then take the answer from that easy coordinate system and apply it to GT. Okay. Now, you see, as you know, there's a formula expressing R as a function of Christoffel symbols and its derivatives. Okay? So, the variation of R can be expressed in terms of the variation of the Christoffel symbol. Now, the Christoffel symbol by itself is not a tensor. But the difference between two Christoffel symbols is a tensor. Now, how do we know that? Well, we know that firstly algebraically. When we derive the transformation properties of the Christoffel symbols. Remember, we had a homogeneous part? And an inhomogeneous part that just depended on derivatives of x by x. This was true, that was that transformation property was true irrespective of what the metric was. Which is an absolutely true transformation property. Suppose you have a Christoffel symbol built out of one metric, and a Christoffel symbol built out of another metric. We subtracted those two Christoffel symbols. The inhomogeneous part cancels in the transformation. So the difference between two Christoffel symbols behaves like a tensor. Okay? This is the algebraic statement of the fact, and you can give a physical interpretation of this, you know. The Christoffel symbol tells you how to parallelly transport something here. So two different ways of parallelly transporting give you two different vectors at the same point. And the difference between two vectors at the same point is a vector. Okay? So, while the Christoffel symbol itself is not a tensor, the difference between two Christoffel symbols is. Okay? So, the small variation of the Christoffel symbol is a tensor. Now, why is that important? That's important because we're going to write the variation of R mu nu in terms of the variation of the Christoffel symbol. But because it's a tensor, we might as well go to a we'll get an expression that's generally coordinate invariant. So we might as well go to a coordinate system in which the Christoffel symbol effect vanishes. Okay. So we'll work at one point, at which the Christoffel symbol vanishes. Now this doesn't mean that the variation of the Christoffel symbol vanishes. Far from it. Okay? But the Christoffel symbol itself vanishes at that point. That must give us great power. Let's see how that works. So let's write down the expression for R mu. So R mu nu, well first remember the expression for R was
members of R, let's say A, B, C, D was equal to, okay, can somebody help me now? Without looking at notes, tell me all these questions. Del mu, gamma A, B, minus del mu, gamma A, B, mu, plus gamma A, let's call it C, yeah, mu, gamma C, B, mu, minus gamma A, C, mu, gamma C, B. Excellent. This was the full remarks. So we want the Ricci it. Okay? In order to get that, what we do is contract the first and third indices. Okay? So, we just said mu is equal to A. Okay? That's A. That's A. That's A. And that's A. Okay? R B mu is equal to this function. Now, I'm interested in computing the variation of this quantity with respect to a small variation of the Christoffel symbol itself, which will ultimately express in terms of variation. Okay? Now, two of these terms obviously don't contribute. In the special coordinate system of interest, two of these terms obviously don't contribute. Which are these two terms? What? The last two, exactly. Because the variation of this multiplies gamma, which vanishes at this point. A special term. Okay? So therefore what we have is that we get delta of R B mu is equal to del A delta gamma A B mu minus del mu delta of gamma A B A. Excellent. And now, we notice the following thing. Now, we're interested not in just delta R mu nu, we're interested in G mu nu times delta R mu. Okay? So let's compute G mu nu times delta R mu nu. So that's G mu nu times times delta R mu nu. And that is equal to del A gamma A B nu minus del nu gamma A B A. Times GV. Well, now this, in this special coordinate system, okay, I claim the following. We'll check it. That if you define W, mu, okay, then let's do that now. Which is WL is equal to G I K gamma I K L. I suppose we call that W A. A minus G I L. I L gamma I K. Then claim this quantity is equal to
1 by square root of minus g d by d d by d x nu square root minus g w. Okay, this is going to be the final claim in an arbitrary coordinate system. What we have to check is that in our coordinate system, derivatives, first derivatives are g of us. So square root minus g is just a bit compressive. Okay, so in our coordinate system, what we have to check is that just del mu w mu, okay, is equal to this quantity. And let's see if that's true. Yeah, that's obvious. Okay, the point is that this del does not act on G, because in our coordinate system, first derivatives are G is here. Okay, so you just take this, and where does B need
it? So it should be B. It should be replaced by another.
B should be replaced by this. Well, B name, right? Okay, so now I just take this quantity here. I contract B and mu. Okay, so this becomes okay, let's say that this is del mu of gamma A B G B mu. Okay, and this was del A of gamma A B mu G B. Presumably these are the same statements. Okay, whether or not actually the same statements, it doesn't matter. We've written these now as terms of derivatives of this one, of these quantities. Okay? Now, because of the tensorial nature, and where is my delta? This should be delta. Sorry. Everything is delta. Delta response. Because of the tensorial nature of this delta of gamma, in this coordinate system I can just replace ordinary derivatives by covariant derivatives. And then the expression will be true in every coordinate system. Okay? So what we've done is take this expression, the variation, and rewrite it as covariant derivative del mu of w mu for some w mu being the sum of this term and this term. Okay? Now, because we've written it as the covariant derivative of some vector field, we have this lovely expression for covariant derivatives, which was square root of g del mu square g. There was a square root of g outside. This cancels this. This is now an ordinary derivative, and we integrate by parts. Okay? So that tells us that there is no local contribution to the variation of the action from the g mu nu delta. Is this clear? Sorry, I said it more confusingly. Is it clear? Unclear to anyone, we can go through.
So when you apply Gauss's theorem to this, you get a surface integral omega.
You get a surface integral of omega mu. Omega mu is built out of delta gamma mu. And in obtaining the equation of motion, we always assume that variations vanish under boundary. That's how the principle of least action works. You look at variations that vanish at a boundary. And then the action should vanish. So this just does not contribute to the action. To the variation of the action at all with the right conditions. Okay? So this term does not contribute to a term in Einstein's equations. And therefore the equation we wrote down on the board right at the beginning was a full Einstein equation. okay, so this is a significant milestone in the course. We have finally written down the correct equation that governs the equation that governs the dynamics of the fluid. Okay, questions or comments about this? Okay. Now, there are a couple of immediate comments about Einstein's equations. One which we made last class, but I'll repeat this. The equation that we wrote down was R mu nu minus half R T mu was equal to 8 pi k t. Now we independently derived the t mu nu, that independently derived the t mu nu is covariantly conserved. So if we take this equation and contract it on both sides, del mu, we get 0 on the right. So this is equal to 0. So it must be true that the left hand side also vanishes. Now, the left hand side vanishing can't come from a new equation of motion, because we already have all the equations of motion. None of the equations of motion are third order derivatives. Okay? So basically the only way this could work is if it was the derivative of a world equation of motion, or if it was an identity. And the way it works in Einstein's equations is that it's an identity. This, in fact, is obtained by contracting the Bianchi identity, as we explained last class. Okay? So the fact that it's this combination, rather than just R mu nu, is something that you could have deduced just by knowing that it's this combination that is covariantly conserved. Okay? Another way of saying it is that once you know, another thing to say is that once you know that Einstein's equations take this form, then you don't have to separately assert the conservation of the stress energy tensor. It follows from the equations itself by taking covariant derivative on both sides that the thing on the right hand side, which you're interpreting as the matter stress tensor, is covariantly conserved. This is an interesting statement because conservation of the stress tensor in the normal field theory results out of the equation of motion. So, once you know the form of the stress tensor of the matter fields under consideration, just by writing down the Einstein's equations, you're asserting part of the equations of motion for the matter fields. Namely, that part that is sufficient, that part that is needed for conservation of the stress tensor. You're not asserting the full equation of motion. Because there are more to the equations of the matter field than conservation of the stress tensor. But you're asserting some part of the equation. However, there is one form of matter for which the only equation of motion is the conservation of the stress tensor. And that form of matter is a fluid. You see, at the fundamental level, Einstein's equations are never all over the place. The thing on the right hand side is the stress tensor of some field. And conservation of the stress tensor for no field that I know of is conservation of the stress tensor of the full content of the equation. Okay? At the fundamental level. But macroscopically, if you've got some macroscopic objects of fluid, the equations of fluid dynamics are simply the statement of energy momentum conservation, supplemented by an equation of state that tells you the form of the stress tensor as a function of thermodynamic benefits. Okay? So for a fluid, what's called perfect fluid, you often write T mu nu is equal to epsilon T mu nu
plus pressure. Now we are using minus is water resistance, okay? And plus pressure times u bar time. Alright, T mu nu is equal to epsilon as u mu plus pressure times, we are using space is negative, so minus g mu nu, and we are using time is positive, so plus. You write down the stress tensor for a fluid, for instance, in this form. Which in the rest frame tells you that in the time component you have the energy density, that's epsilon. And in the space directions you've got an isotropic pressure. Okay, this is the projection of space. You're removing the time part from it. Okay, so this is the now this is not complete unless you tell me what epsilon is in terms of B. Some sort of equation of state is. So you need to know some information about the fluid that you want. But once you put that information in, the only dynamics in fluid dynamics is the assertion of conservation of the stress tensor. So for the particular case of general relativity, coupled to a fluid, all you need is Einstein's equations supplemented by a constitutive relationship of this form for the fluid. Now the constitutive relationship tells you what pressure is in terms of energy, or what energy and pressure both are in terms of a temperature or a particle or something like that. Okay? And then these just Einstein's equations gives you all the dynamic equations. You don't separately have to impose conservation stress tensor, it's automatic. Okay. So in that case, some constitutive relationship of this form plugged in here gives you the full equation of motion. Of the system. Okay, this is a very special case, but it's an important special case because it's one we will use a lot when we're discussing cosmology. Because cosmology deals with the evolution of the universe in large scales, and there you don't care about the fundamental fields, you treat all those things as fluids. Okay? So this is the structure of Einstein's equations in the special case that you're dealing with fluids. In general, of course, you need to supplement Einstein's equations with the equations of the matter. So, for instance, if you're dealing with Einstein's equations coupled to electromagnetism, you have Einstein's equations that we've been here, plus you have Maxwell's equations, which we wrote down two or three classes earlier. And these two equations together form the full dynamics set of the full set of equations. Okay, so this was the first one. The second comment is about the structural nature of Einstein's equations. Okay? And just to lead up to this comment, I'm going to tell you about similar things in the study of just U1 electromagnetics. So for the next 5 minutes, we're going to retreat to a class on electrodynamics and to study the structure of the equations of Maxwell electrodynamics. So let's remember the structure of the equations of Maxwell electrodynamics. The equations of Maxwell electrodynamics are some constants that will not bother us. So what I'm going to say.
So are you only doing it for the case of the fluid?
Yes.
Then, like when you query with respect to the matter fields and get the equations of motion for the matter fields, shouldn't an analogous thing happen for fluid fields?
Yeah, you see, equations of fluid dynamics don't follow from varying action. Yeah. Not in a known way. This is an interesting question that I'm actually working on. It must in some way. The simple answer to the question is that that's not the way how you get the equations. You know, some effective coarse grained equations that are just asserted in the system. Okay? They will come by coarse graining the equations of the fundamental matter fields that do follow from varying action. Yeah, it's an excellent question, but that's it. Okay. Fine. Okay. Now, let's retreat to the study of Maxwell electrodynamics. These are the equations of Maxwell. Okay. Now, looking at these equations, you might think, now the question I'm going to ask is, what is the initial data? If I wanted, let's suppose for a moment that J nu was a given specified field. And I'm asking the question, how much initial data do I need to completely specify the evolution of the electrodynamic field at all times in the future? Okay? The naivest case might be, okay, first, suppose you just have minimally coupled scalar, just a scalar field, and, okay, and you ask, how much data do I need to specify, just to set the normalization? I'm going to call that two pieces of data, because you have to specify two functions at an initial spatialized, namely the value of the scalar field and the value of its first time measure. That is the data that specifies the future evolution of the scalar. This I refer to as two pieces of data. It's two infinity that we're looking at. Okay, two functions worth of data. Okay. Now, if you're completely naive, you look at this and say, well, there are four scalar fields. So presumably I have to specify eight pieces of data. Okay? In order to look at the specify the future evolution of this the system. This is totally and absolutely wrong. Okay? Now a little less naively, you might say, well, we know of these four functions, one of them is gauge. Okay? One of them is gauge. So maybe the answer is that you have to specify three pieces of data. For instance, you can work in a gauge in which you set one field to zero, and the remaining three, but even that's wrong. Okay? The answer is even less than 3. Actually, the answer is 2. And we'll get to that soon. Okay? The answer is even less than 3. As we're going to see now by the following device. Look, of this equation, so what I'm going to do, you know, by data, I mean function in space. So by that statement, I'm breaking the Lorentz invariance. Okay, because I've chosen my slice to be along t is equal to constant. Okay, so there is one special equation. Namely the equation in which nu takes the value 0. Let's study that equation. That equation is del nu of f mu 0 is equal to j 0. Now, the first thing to notice is that mu runs over all values. But the part where mu is equal to 0 is trivial. Is 0. Because f 0 is 0. So this is actually sum over I, del I, f I 0. Now, f I 0 has time derivatives of fields. It's a one derivative object, so it has at most one time. Del I is a purely spatial index. Okay? So all these equations are only one time derivative. Sorry, all these terms are this equation. So this term is an equation in terms of time, a single time derivative or no time derivatives. There are no terms with two time derivatives. Okay? Moreover, which field's time derivatives appear in this function? Does A0's time derivative appear? No. A0 appears, but only as del I is 0. Del 0 of AI appears. So, this thing depends on AI dot A0 by itself and spatial derivatives. Spatial derivatives are not counted. Again? And that's it. And of course, AI. Actually, AI doesn't. It does not have even a single time derivative of A0. Okay. This this immediately tells you that there is even less data than the three pieces of data. Why is that? Because this relationship here on any time slice is an equation relating bits of what you might otherwise think of as independent data. Okay? So the answer is some number less than 3. Okay. Now, we're going to find that number in a moment. But even before we do that, there's another little exercise I want to do with this equation. The exercise I want to do is the following. Look, so what we've learned is this. Normally, in a classical system, you specify data and dynamics are opposite. Okay. What we've learned is that the zero equation is not an equation that helps you evolve data. It's an equation that constrains what data you're allowed to start with. Where in phase space you're allowed to start. Okay? The I equations, on the other hand, have genuine time derivatives of it. There's double derivatives of everything. Of the AI fields. Those are genuine dynamic equations. Okay? So in the study of Maxwell equations, you break up the equations into two parts if you're interested in time. Nice and round space. The zero equation is called the constraint equation. Okay? It's a Hausdorff constraint equation. And the I equations are called the dynamic equations. Now, something that you might worry is the following. You might worry, suppose I've set the constraint at one slice. And I use dynamics to evolve my constraint data. Could it be that I run into a contradiction? Could it be that the data that I get at future time slice does not obey the constraints at that time slice? Okay? If so, these equations would be inconsistent. Of course, that's not the case, but we have to prove that's not the case. Do you understand my worry? You understand? You see, because all data is not allowed. That's what the fourth equation say. The zero equations. So now if you start with allowed data, dynamics should evolve you to allowed data, otherwise you're in trouble. Okay? What would ensure that that's true? What would ensure that that's true is if del zero of the constraint was zero by the dynamic equations. Okay? So let's compute del zero of the constraint. Del zero of del mu f mu zero. Okay? Which was del zero of del I zero. Now, let's remember what the dynamical equations. The dynamical equations are del mu of f mu I is equal to 0. So that, now I break this up into the 0 and the j parts. So that's del 0 of f 0 I plus del j of f j I is equal to 0. So if I've got a term that's del 0 of f 0 I, I can replace it by del j of f j I. By taking the del 0 through here, I've got such a term, so I've got del I with a minus sign of del j of f j r, which is equal to 0 because of the asymmetry. Okay? So we proved exactly what we want to prove. That is that the time derivative of the constraint equation vanishes by use of the dynamic equations. So that if you take your data and it obeys the constraint at one time slice. Okay? Then it will always obey the constraint. Okay. Good. So we've learned many things. We've learned that Maxwell's equations have two types of equations. There are the dynamical equations and the constraint equations. The constraint equations constrain data and so reduce your degrees of freedom by to less than 3. The dynamical equations evolve data, but evolve it in a way that is consistent with constraints. Okay, now what we have to do, what's left to do, is some count. How many degrees of freedom? Okay, in order to do that, it's convenient to fix to a particular age. Okay, I'm going to do it in one convenient gauge, but in the exercises I'll make you do it. I'll request you to do it in 7 different gauges, just to make sure you see that you get the same answer. Okay, and the convenient gauge turns out, the most convenient gauge turns out to be called Coulomb gauge. Then I have it. Okay, in this gauge, we fix this gauge. This you can always do, by the way. Because if del I is not zero, then you do a gauge transformation. The equation you have to solve on the gauge transformation to make it zero is Laplacian, or gauge for transformation, is minus old del I, right? And the Laplacian in this is an inverted. Spatial Laplace. Is that an inverted? So you can always go to this gauge. Okay? So you go to this gauge, and now in this gauge, let's count degrees of freedom. So let's see what the constraint equation becomes in this case. In this gauge, the constraint equation becomes del. So what was it? It was del I fi 0 is equal to j 0. But fi 0 was del 0 ai, or del I 0 minus del 0 ai. Do you see that the del 0 ai term vanishes because of this gauge constraint? Because it's del I of del 0 ai, take the del 0 out, del 0 of del I ai, which is 0. So all that remains here is the del I is 0. Okay, so this equation, the constraint equation in this gauge becomes del I squared a 0 is equal to j 0, and we have the sign block. Which tells you that a0 at any spatial slice is determined by what j0 is doing. In particular, if j0 was 0, a0 would be set to 0. The Laplacian is an inverted operator. Okay? So now, how many degrees of freedom are there? Because we've completely exhausted the content of the constraint equations. Okay? We've completely exhausted the content the solution to this equation is unique of imposing reasonable boundary conditions. Okay. We completely exhausted the content of the constraint equation. The remaining two equations are dynamic equations. You can write them down and say there's no constraint. It's just second. It gives you second derivatives in time in terms of first. Other things. They are ordinary. So now how many degrees of freedom are there? Clearly? 2. Right? You set one, you got it at 1 degree of freedom by gauge fixing, and the constraint killed the whole other degree of freedom. Okay? Is this clear? Sorry. Is this clear? Okay, it's less easy to see this in other gauges, but it's always possible. And we'll set a couple of exercises. We'll set an exercise. Please note that. We'll set an exercise for you, asking you to do this in one or two gauges, just to get the hang of this in this very simple linear system of equations. That's actually.
Can you explain what
just
like kill?
Why does that kill off a degree of freedom? Because now what's left? What means? What are the remaining fields in the problem? There's only AI, but AI constraints such that del AI is equal to 0. This scale is 1 degree of freedom. One less function. So 3 minus 1. Okay? Now, why have I dropped this all up in the middle of a course in general relativity? You don't need to be geniuses to guess that the same thing is going to be true. Something very similar is going to be true in Einstein's equations. Okay? So, let's see how that works. Okay? So that's our next exercise. We're going to analyze the structure of Einstein's equations.
these are the equations of right now again without this. Let's just rub off the dead part. And let me write to this. Now, Einstein's equation can also be divided up into dynamic equations and constraint equations. It turns out that there are four constraint equations, and the remaining equations are dynamic. The four constraint equations are any of the equations with any factor of zero at all. In this way, I'm writing it zero at the top. Okay, so I'm claiming that R zero mu minus half. Now writing it like this, this is delta mu. So R zero I is equal to 8 pi j t zero I, and R zero zero minus R by 2 is equal to 8 pi k t 0 0. These equations are 3 plus 1 constraint equations. By I mean all indices that are not zero, spatial. Yes. So if any choice of coordinates, actually, whether so what am I going to show? I'm going to show that actually it doesn't matter which one. So I choose one particular coordinate, whether it's time or space, it doesn't matter. I'm going to show that these equations have no terms of second derivative in this coordinate. No, no. This is g upper 0 lower 3, which is delta. And delta 0 I is zero. That's part of the reason I went to 1. Okay. Now, in order to understand this, it's worth taking a little time to understand this. So I'm going to remind you of our expression for the second derivative. Okay. You remember in the last class. We developed a nice and more convenient expression for many purposes for the curvature tensor. That part had four second derivative cases and two parts that were products of couplings. You remember this, right? I'm going to write down the part that was the second derivative part for convenience. Which is that R E I K L M I K L M is equal to 3 2 by G I L X. Okay, let's put commas G I M comma K L half twice plus G K L comma I am minus G I L comma K M minus G K M comma I L. It's always a very good question. Okay, excellent. Fine. So, now just using this expression, I want to show that there are no terms of second derivative in time. And let's start with R is equal. Okay, so let's remember. What was R0i? R0i was G big, or IKLM like we have here. Then we make it an R. So we contract to make KNM. This one's KM. And we take this L index. Alright, L is capital. Okay, we take this L index and raise it to 0. GL is. Okay, so what do we have to do here? I have to take this expression and take GKM GL is.
How about this?
just to be consistent. Okay. So, R0 nu minus half del nu. Sorry, what was I doing? I am just expanding this. So, del, and this was just minus R. That's the del 0 part. Then, is equal to minus and then the I part. So, del I R I nu plus half del I R. I've just taken that equation and expanded it out. This is a term with del zeros, especially. Notice that the term with del zero is precisely the pieces that we want. I'm sorry, I did this wrong. So, this term contributes, this term exists only when nu is equal to zero. Exactly the del zero of the equations of motion that we wanted to focus on, the constraint equations. Now, what does it tell you? This tells you that del zero of the equations, of the constraint equations, is del I of dynamical equations. But we know that del I, that dynamical equations, are no more than two derivatives of anything. In particular, no more than two time derivatives. Actually, the del I of them, that doesn't increase the number of time derivatives. So the right hand side has at most two time derivatives. In fact, it does have two time derivatives. Therefore, the left hand side can have at most two time derivatives. But there's an explicit time derivative. Because del zero has a factor which is just d zero. Therefore, this is, if this term here had an explicit time derivative, this would make this third order, which would contradict the fact that we know that the right hand side is no higher than second order term. Okay? So this is a slick argument for the same conclusion, that the constrained Einstein equations are at most first order term.
Correct to say, I mean, in this wording, is that L0 is like you are containing on the constraint surface.
Say that again.
My basic question is, I mean, when you do, then the conservation of the stress energy tensor, can it be in some sort of way related to that being of an origin of constraints rather than that?
Question is the fact that the stress tensor is conserved in the heart of the constraints. Maybe there's a way of saying it, seeing it in which this is true. It's not how I'm thinking of it at the moment. There may be a way of doing it. I'm not sure. Okay. So let's proceed. Where are we? Okay, so we've concluded that just like the Maxwell equations, the Einstein equations also can be decomposed into constraint and dynamical. Okay, now, there are two things we're going to relegate to the problem sets. One is the demonstration that we did in a few minutes ago, that just like for the Maxwell equations, if the constraint equations are satisfied at one time slice, they continue to be satisfied at all future time slices, and that this follows simply from the dynamic equations. I mean, the answer is basically it's more or less. So that derivative of the constraint equation is related to it's related to dynamic equations, but you're going to make the process. Okay? The other thing that we're going to try to so now that we've understood that the equations split up with dynamic and constraint, let's try to do some counting.
The first part of that thing, the initial part that proves the second derivative is zero.
Yes.
But that equation is actually directly written from the fact that it's going to be zero. I mean, if that works, since R is not there, R is zero, it is zero.
I didn't answer. Tell me again what you want to do.
Same to like the question from us, that how much of this can be related to derivative of zero is equal to zero.
Now you're talking about the Maxwell.
Yeah.
So energy with that. If mu is equal to zero, then
just by logic. The first part.
First part is say precisely what you want to say. Let me write down an equation that you want to prove.
So the relation that we have is R A B C D is analogous to F B.
You're saying that we know that R is like a fixed strength, and therefore it should be true just from that. Which thing do you want to now use this proof that there are no time derivatives?
In the first part, R is zero, right?
Well, you know, if you use that analogy exactly, it will give you one constraint equation. Gauge theories have a single constraint. Einstein's equations are four. Now, you might say that's because, you would say, no, that's the wrong way to count. Gauge theories have one matrix value constraint equation. That's giving you two minutes. That will give you four. You see, the fact that the path that was your matrix also involves derivatives is sort of important. I would have to think, but it's not clear to me that you can use the analogy straightforwardly. It doesn't seem to be giving the right answer. Yeah, perhaps there probably is a way to think about it deeply. I don't see it much. Okay, excellent. Good question. Okay, fine. Now let's do some naive counting, and then the actual counting, a way of actually understanding the actual counting will either, like the kind of thing that we did in the Coulomb gauge, I'll try to explain it in the next class. Okay. Firstly, naively there are 10 degrees of freedom. Or 10 fields, or what we were calling 20 degrees of freedom. Okay? Gauge freedom can be used to get rid of 10 or 4 of the 10 fields. So there are 6 fields, or what you might want to call 12 degrees of freedom. 4 constraint equations can be used to get rid of 12 of these degrees of freedom. So you might think that what's left is 8 degrees of freedom. 8 functions. Okay? But this is the kind of wrong counting you could have done in gauge theory. Let's review it, how you might have done this wrong in gauge theory. Gauge theory, you might have said, well, there were... Okay, let's count in terms of fields rather than degrees of freedom. Okay, let me say what I said in the terms of fields. Naively, there were 10 fields. Get rid of 4 by gauge. 6, and then constraint equations give you get rid of 4 functions. So you might have solved 2 degrees of freedom. So you might have thought you're left with 4 degrees of freedom. That's wrong. The answer is you're left with 2 degrees of freedom. Okay. Let's just see how you might have done it wrong in these. How might you have done it wrong? You might have engaged here, you might have argued that well, there were 4 functions, you get rid of 1 by gauge, that leaves 3. And then you get rid of half more from the constraints. Constraints 1 equation. So it says we're getting rid of one function. But when we actually did engage theory, we saw that the constraint got rid of a full degree. It eliminated all of these. You could completely solve for the easy. Okay? The same thing will turn out to be true for that. That the constraints are sufficient to eliminate a full 4 degrees of freedom. So you lose 4 degrees of freedom by gauge. And 4 degrees, further 4 degrees of freedom, full 4 degrees of freedom by constraints. And you're left with 2 degrees of freedom in the air. The number of degrees of freedom in the gravitational field is the same as the number of degrees of freedom in the electromagnetic field. And you can think of these as the two polarizations of the photon, or the two polarizations of that. As we will see when we study gravitational waves. Gravitational waves also have 2 polarizations. We'll see this probably in the next class, and then as we go on through the course, you'll see this better and better. Okay? So, this is the final answer to the issue, to what structure the initial value problem of Einstein's equation is. Once you've done all this blah 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 with constraints and dynamics, you're left with 2 field worths of degrees of freedom associated with the 2 polarizations. Okay. So I'll stop this general formal structural discussion now after your question. In the next class, we'll return to more practical matters after maybe a little pouring back into this formal stuff. But we'll return to this through the course to understand better the structure of these equations. Question?
How does this argument change in higher dimensions? For the Maxwell's case, add 1 more degree of freedom.
Let's do the counting. It's a very good question. Let's do the counting in higher dimensions. Okay? Let's first do the counting for Maxwell's equations in D dimensions. Then we'll do the counting for Einstein's equations in D dimensions. Okay? So, Maxwell's equations in D dimensions. A mu looks like it has... Okay, so let's suppose we were in D plus 1. D space 1. 1 time. So that our universe is 3, these 3. Okay? Then, the same logic that we used, okay, the same logic that we used gets from 1 degree of freedom by gauge, 1 full degree of freedom by constraint. So you've got d minus 1 degrees of freedom. This is the dimension of the vector of S of d minus 1, which is the little group of a massless particle in D plus 1 dimensions, as some of you may know. Okay? Now let's look at what we get. Now let's look at what we get from for the science sections. So once again, the Einstein business, what do we have to start? Naive counting is D into D plus 1 by 2. Number of components in cosine. D plus 1 into D plus 2 by 2. Number of components in a d plus 1 cross d plus 1 symmetric matrix. Okay? Now, you get rid of d plus 1 degrees of freedom because of gauge, and d plus 1 because of constraints. So minus 2 in d plus 1. So, this is d plus 1 into d plus 2 by 2. This is the number of components in the matrix. Okay? Now I subtract d plus 1 degrees of freedom because of gauge freedom, and another d plus 1 because of the constraints. Okay? So that's minus 2 into d plus 1. Okay? So what do we have? So we've got d plus 2, the whole thing by 2. So we take d plus 1 common, so d plus 1 into d plus 2 by 2 minus 2. Okay? So that's d plus 1 into d minus 2 by 2. Now, let's first check this. Suppose we said d equals 3, that would be 4 by 2, so that gives you 2. Then that looks okay. And now let's try to interpret this. You see, this should be the dimension of the irreducible representation in which the graviton transforms. Now, the graviton transforms as some representation of SOD minus 1. Which representation? It's the symmetric traceless representation. Okay, number of symmetric components in D minus 1 dimensions, D minus 1 in a D by 2. But then you have to remove the trace. Just again check in two dimensions to see that four dimensions is going right.
D plus 1.
What?
D plus 1.
No. This is of SOD minus 1.
Oh, SOD.
The little group is D minus. SOD minus 1. SO2 for it. So this is 2 in a 3 by 2, so 3 minus 1. So that's correct. Okay. Now, the remaining exercise is to check these two are equal. So let's work it out. It should be within our capabilities. D squared minus D minus 2 by 2, and this is d squared minus d minus 2. Okay.
So this means that you're representing graviton by
symmetric traces. Is it? The graviton is a particle in the end. Small fluctuations of particle. Every particle transforms in some irreducible representation of its little group. If, for those of you who know what this means, okay, if you don't know what this means. Okay. What representation does the graviton transform in? Symmetric traces. Okay, so this is the answer. The answer to the number of degrees of freedom in the equations. It should have been a good homework exercise. Okay, other question. Okay, so in the next class we will turn from these formal considerations to actually solving Einstein's equations. We'll write down the Schwarzschild metric, we'll compute the orbits of planets, we'll start having fun. Okay.